Penguin Random House Audio presents The Courage of Compassion, A Journey from Judgment to Connection by Robin Steinberg. Contributions by Camilo Ramirez. This is the author, Robin Steinberg. To our children's children's children. The stories in this book are true. Everything from personal conversations to courtroom proceedings reflects my best but surely imperfect memories of the events. A letter from Simon Sinek. I started Optimism Press to help advance a vision of the world that does not yet exist, a world in which the vast majority of people wake up every single morning inspired, feel safe wherever they are, and end the day fulfilled by the work they do. The single best way for us to build this world is if we commit to building it together. But there's a problem. We will be able to build that world only if we can truly listen to one another. But we don't. Instead, we speak at one another. We have reduced those with whom we disagree into caricatures that we can easily dismiss or even hate. We argue about things with a kind of rigid moral authority we don't have, both sides believing they are on the side of right and good, and seeing the other side as wrong or evil. And because we too often succumb to the us versus them, we become unable to see the other side in their full humanity, which hijacks any opportunity to foster genuine connection or dialogue. That's where the courage of compassion comes in. This is a book told through the lens of criminal justice, but it is not about criminal justice. The real story is about learning to see all people as human, complicated, messy humans, no matter what. Robin Steinberg directly challenges us to consider the question, what if your entire life were defined by the worst thing you ever did? And if we don't want that for ourselves, and we have all said or done unethical or shameful things in our lives, then how can we do that to others? The answer, it turns out, is as complicated as the journey to get there. The courage of compassion is determined, however, to go on that journey with us. You will hear about cases of justice and injustice. Parts of this book will make you angry. Parts will make you sad. Parts will frustrate you. You will find yourself judging people you don't know, maybe even the author. And that's the point. This book pushes us to take ourselves on. It challenges us to replace our judgment with curiosity. I chose to publish a book written by one of the pioneers of a controversial topic, criminal justice and bail reform, for the same reason I founded a nonprofit organization called the Curve Initiative, which works with police chiefs and sheriffs from across the country to help evolve the culture of policing from the inside out. Though these two groups are often pitted against each other, the truth is, many people on both sides share a very similar vision of the world, despite what appear to be intractable obstacles to change. If we want to improve our institutions and make this world a better place, we have to be willing to learn to listen to and work with people with whom we don't agree and may not even like for one very simple reason. We cannot make peace only with our friends. If we are to find any common ground to benefit the greater good, we have to find ways to see those on the other side as human and extend a hand. If we want to live in a world in which we feel seen and heard and understood, we have to find a way to look beyond our differences and recognize how much we have in common. And the single best way to do that is to learn the courage of compassion. Show compassion and inspire on. Simon Sinek. An invitation. Could you love someone who committed murder? I'm not talking about someone wrongfully accused or even someone with a legal justification for taking the life of another. I'm talking about someone who did it, pure and simple. Can you imagine yourself caring for them? Maybe more to the point, why would you want to? For the past 40 years, I have explored these questions, not as a philosopher or an academic, but as a lifelong public defender and social justice advocate. In my role as a public defender, I have defended people charged with things as insignificant as riding their bicycle on a public sidewalk and as significant as viciously shooting someone in the head for no apparent reason. With each client and each story, I grappled with the moral, political, and real-life implications of defending someone charged with committing a crime as everyone around me asked the question, how can you defend those people? There is no single answer. I'm not sure that even after a long career in the trenches, I can fully answer the question. What I do know is that the system we've created to adjudicate right and wrong and determine criminal responsibility and punishment is deeply flawed. Over the past couple of years, there has been an awakening about the ways in which America's criminal justice system has perpetuated racism and injustice. People on both sides of the aisle are calling for change. However, does recognizing the need for change and even saying it out loud lead us down the path to real reform? Is the recognition alone enough to create the necessary change? I wish it were that simple. Seeing the systemic flaws is a necessary first step to change, but it will not be enough. The truth is that we are a deeply punitive people. In the new court of public opinion, our desire for social and racial justice is bold and restorative. But in our courts of law, even amid today's movement for change, justice more closely resembles bloodthirst. What propels us to continue such cruelty? Why do we punish so unforgivingly? Why do we reduce people to their worst moment rather than see them in the fullness of their humanity? After many years of fighting from within the system, I have realized that a big part of the problem lies within each one of us. Our inability to recognize ourselves in those people and see our shared humanity is at the heart of our cruelty. It is that distance that has enabled our criminal justice system to operate for generations, crushing the people who become ensnared in it. So what will it take to transform our criminal justice system? Nothing short of changing ourselves, one person at a time. Let's be honest, we're all criminals. Each one of us has done something that could be defined as criminal. Driving home after a few too many drinks, taking an illegal drug, getting into an argument that turned physical, or being less than truthful on a tax return. These are all crimes. Some of us have been arrested. Others of us have been lucky or privileged enough to evade prosecution. Whether or not our crimes have landed us in the criminal justice system or not, we are all flawed, and none of us wants to be defined by our most shameful moment. Indeed, the words, "that's not who I am," have been uttered in equal quantity by those charged with burglary and those charged with crimes related to storming the Capitol on January 6th. Let me be clear. I'm not suggesting that people shouldn't be held accountable for their crimes. We should all be held to account for the things we have done wrong and the harm they might have caused. That goes without saying. But what that looks like and how we administer justice must consider the context of an act and the humanity of the actor. This book will take you into America's criminal justice system and into the lives and stories of some of the people caught in it, people whom I represented over the years and who taught me the most important lessons of my career. I hope that this proximity to them will open your eyes to how our system operates, but I hope you will go deeper, as I myself have done in this book, by reflecting on my own personal story, my career as a public defender, and the experiences that shaped me. In sharing my path, I also hope you'll recognize some truths about yourself. I'm inviting you to go on a journey to face your own judgments, fears, and beliefs, and to recognize how they might be reflected in our systems. This journey may be emotional. It will for sure make you frustrated at times. And it may even make some of you mad enough to stop listening. But one thing is for certain, this journey will take courage. Chapter 1. How can you defend those people? Like every public defender, I've been asked this question countless times at parties, holiday meals, family gatherings, in the courtroom, and even on the street after a trial. People have also demanded an answer in hate mail, media interviews, and other less than friendly venues. My responses range from the flippant to the philosophical and purely political. The fundamental importance of the right to counsel, the primacy of the presumption of innocence, the need to check government power, mass incarceration. Frankly, these answers are the autopilot reply for a career defender. And there is truth in them. But they do not fully explain why I chose to devote my life to defending people at the mercy of our criminal justice system and dedicate myself to changing it. In recent years, many social justice organizations and advocates have started using the term criminal legal system rather than criminal justice system to describe America's system of jails and prisons, criminal courts, prosecution, and policing. The argument is that the current system does not deliver justice. Thus, to call it so is inaccurate and corrupts the meaning of justice. Indeed, as we know all too well, the fact that something is legal does not make it just or right. I agree with the spirit of this argument. However, I have chosen to use the term criminal justice system throughout this book because the moral challenge, as I see it, is transforming what we mean and expect from justice in the first place. The truth is that Americans largely expect retribution in response to harm and wrongdoing when it comes to the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.